I'm very excited to be able to introduce our two panelists. Our first panelist took the opportunity of a beauty queen crown to stand up to communist China after they refused to let her come compete in the world championships that she was supposed to go compete in. She's now spent her time talking about China, how they have become a geopolitical force, and maybe give us some ideas of what we should be looking for. And our moderator for this, Jillian K. Melchior, you read her, she's honestly one of the most well-traveled young women, because she's still a young woman, but she primarily has been writing a lot lately on Hong Kong and China, and I know that we are going to learn a lot from both of them. If we could welcome Anastasia Lin and Jillian K. Melchior to the stage, that'd be wonderful.
You guys are in for such a treat with this speaker. Anastasia's quite young, but also quite accomplished. She's been one of the most fearless voices for human rights in China that I've met. And she's somebody who gives me hope, because you see the Chinese Communist Party, what a chokehold it has over its people, not just from a position of government and power, but in terms of brainwashing. And she's somebody who's been able to break that ideological mold and criticize the Chinese government, knowing full well what it's like from the inside. So I'm so excited you're here.
Thank you so much.
I wanted to begin a little bit with the story of how your mind has changed about China. I know you were talking about how you grew up in their brainwashed propagandistic system and how it was a revelation to you what the nature of the regime was really like. So tell us a little bit about what you learned about China in China growing up, and what changed your mind.
All right, thank you. It's my honor to be here to speak to you. I was born in China and lived there for 13 years. I was one of the luckier ones, because my family in China, at least in my father and my mother's generation, were not severely persecuted as political minority. My father, he was a successful businessman. Before the communist, before recently, his business was taken away. And my mother was a university professor, and she taught Western economics. So I grew up in a political correct background by Chinese communist standard. So I was able to get access to, for example, become the student leader. And part of my job is to gather students together and talk about what the government want us to talk about. But at that time, it did not feel that I was complicit in the government's propaganda. It felt like it was the right thing to do, because the society was building a way that if you're good, if you're an elite, then you became attracted to join the Communist Party to gain even more profit and status in the communist society. So until I came to Canada, a lot of the things were completely sealed off from my knowledge. And after I came out, it's not like you came off the plane and you breathe the fresh air of freedom and you suddenly change your mind. No, it takes a very long time of self-examination and also learning about the world. Even a lot of Chinese immigrants you see today, like university students, they still defend communism in historical classes or in Western universities. They do not agree with the values of freedom or human rights or simply reason. So I guess that's a very short version of how I came to learn about the West.
So what's the first thing when you were a young person, when you'd first come to the West, that opened your eyes, that made you second guess what you learned about the Chinese government in school? What made you question the propaganda that they taught you?
Right, I guess the first thing one would notice is that in the West, people are a lot more relaxed, a lot more chill, because you didn't grow up in a society where survival of the fittest is the structure of the society. People had trust between each other, family had trust, compassion is valued as something one should work towards. And that has to do with the continuation of your beliefs and your values, your history. But unfortunately, in China, we experienced cultural revolution. We experienced numerous political movements that took these human relations away. And today, people became, even though the economy has become a lot better, the distrust, the atomized unit of individual in that society creates a very defensive mechanism when they deal with people. So that's when I realized, why are people able to live with such trust and compassion? And then so I read more. And then through that, my mother also brought home a lot of news sources that are not the same as communist official propaganda. So in China, there's no media. Well, I guess I should say the media are used as a tool to broadcast communist propaganda. You don't expect much truth from the media, which means there's no real independent journalism at all. And there are courageous journalists who are trying to tell Chinese people the truth, but oftentimes their courage is met with a lot of difficulty and setback.
So what did your mom give you to read that you were mentioning that she brought home news that was different than what you heard in China?
Yeah,
tell me a little bit about that.
She brought home a Hong Kong newspaper that talked about June 4th massacre, and she brought back a flyer of Falun Gong. So those two are one of the two most sensitive topics for Chinese communist regime. Tiananmen massacre, I've never heard of it in China of my 13 years. I was born 6 months after the Tiananmen massacre has happened. And there's no mention of it, not in the historical books. The journalists don't talk about it. Our parents' generation never dared to talk to us about it. Of course, it's understandable. If we hear about it, we go to school and talk to our friends about it, they get into trouble back home. And so when I first heard of the massacre, I went online immediately to look at the videos. And that was the most shocking thing. In China, the communists try to project a society that's always stable, always harmonious. There's nobody with a different voice. Everybody's happy. And even if they have different voice, the Communist Party is always glorious, righteous, and correct. And they will take care of everything. And I guess because I did not grow up in a dissident family, so even though my great-grandfather and grandparents' generation were heavily persecuted by the Communist Party, but I never heard about it. So yeah, and then with the persecution of Falun Gong, that is a huge population of Chinese that is being demonized. Hatred propaganda was spread about them all over China. I even helped to organize my classmates to listen to Chinese official CCTV propaganda about how they were bad and occult. And only after I came out did I realize that they were Buddhist school practitioners.
So that must have been a really painful discovery for you to realize that the country and the government that you looked up to not only wasn't what it said it was, but was brutalizing its own people. So can you talk about what emotionally that was like for you? And also, it's a long way from personally realizing that to fearlessly speaking out on it. So how did you get there?
Well, I felt like there were more excitement than fear, because I realized I was in a free society. I had access to these information. I had people around me that supported me to discover these information. And that itself was tremendous support. And I guess I was never fearless when I spoke about human rights in China. My family, except for my mother, everybody else is still in China. Everybody's been harassed by the police. Everybody's been harassed by the police repeatedly. Sometimes 13 or a group of policemen would come to intimidate them. And these are not even direct relatives, they're far relatives. My uncle's aunt or my mother's ex-boyfriend, these people. And it's scary for them, and it's more scary for me, because I wouldn't know what would I do as the next step would break the status quo right now and throw one of them in jail. But it's a chess game I have to play with myself. Because I also realized that by speaking about the Chinese people's condition and the persecution that's happening in China, it also helped me to become a totally different person. And hopefully I can inspire other Chinese people to do so.
One of the things that struck me traveling to China and learning a bit about the history is how much the communists destroyed. What a great civilization this was. and how they not only destroyed freedom, they not only destroyed civil society, but this deep, rich intellectual culture. Can you talk to me a little bit about what was lost under communism and how they accomplished that, specifically through the Cultural Revolution?
Mm-hmm. Our culture is a culture that's inspired by divine. We hold Confucian's value as one of the core value in our society. There's also Buddhist value and Taoist. In Confucian, what they promoted is very similar to what Socrates talked about as the philosopher king in the Republic, that the rulers should always have almost like a saint inside and perfect one's personal character and come out to regulate the society. So it's a very inward-oriented society. There was only one dynasty in China called Qing Dynasty, not the latest Qing Dynasty, but a period that's earlier that united China, but it followed also legalism. It's not rule of law. Legalism is different. The Chinese legalism assumes that people are originally bad. And they united China, but they lasted for a very short period of time, 15 years. In general, Chinese culture promoted Confucian value of compassion and to be in accordance with nature. What you do, the demeanor, the righteousness is a core principle to follow. And when communists came in, of course, our 5,000 years of culture is very hard to take away overnight. So they did numerous political movements to destruct our society gradually. First, what they did, right after they took over power. In other society, like when the regime wanted to take over power, they kill before they take over the power. After they establish the power, they try to rule. But for communists, it's different. After they take over the power, the killing starts. First, they would, through the reform of land, kill the landlord, chief landlord. And these landlords, these spires, are the root of Chinese traditional society on a town level. Chinese government, in the traditional sense, start from a central government and reach down to the town level. And below the town, the central government has no say. It's from the spire, the local community, that it regulates itself. So these people are almost a continuation of the foundation of Chinese society. Once you take them away, it's like taking away the heart of the society. And then through different movements such as Wufan, Sufan, these, the target is different in each one, but the aim is to kill in order to establish fear. Some are targeted toward entrepreneurs, some are targeted toward businessmen, basically the aim was to take their wealth, and they say we'll redistribute to people, but they never did. And through all these movements in the 1950s, and by the end, there's the 100 flower blooming, and then...
Explain what that is.
Right, so Mao Zedong understands that the intellectuals of Chinese society holds the institutional memory of what we were before. As long as they exist, they still have the mechanism or the knowledge to bring things back to what it was before. So he encouraged everybody to give advice and criticism to the Communist Party, and they called it the 100 flower blooming at the same time. But then after that happened, that's in 1956, and in 1957, immediately the Youfan, which is what they call anti-right movement. So they called all these intellectuals as the right side, like the
as
political
rightists.
Left.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, rightist. And they were persecuted. The number of people who were being persecuted in this persecution, there were different estimates. Some say it's in the 55,000, some say it's in the millions. But because in communist society, history and documentation of what happened sometimes is very difficult. So it's very hard to get what actually happened on a town and a detailed level.
So this was a campaign that had people stick their heads out, speak the truth, and then penalize them for doing that.
Yes.
And then it was followed by the Cultural Revolution. Can you talk to me a little bit about the dynamics of the Cultural Revolution? What were people trying to say they wanted in culture that they didn't have? And how did they accomplish it? Talk to me a little bit about the political violence around that and what the legacy of it has been.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's a part of history that's really crucial to understanding China today, but it's one I think Americans don't understand well.
Right, thank you. Mm-hmm. It's a really important question for, I think, you and for all my country. Back in 1966, a group of Chinese high school students in Tsinghua High School, and they gathered together in Yuanmingyuan and started this movement. Well, of course, they are not an initiator, but it seems like that the whole movement stemmed from that incident. They decided to basically attack all the old moral authorities, intellectuals, and it quickly got violent. So that was in June 1966, and it spread among the high schools. So the high schools were starting to be very physical against their teachers. And the first death occurred, I think, in August. And when they killed someone, one of their teacher, they reported to the vice mayor of Beijing at that time, and they were kind of scared because they killed someone. And then the vice mayor said, it's okay, if you killed them, they killed him. And then they got the encouragement that this is an okay thing to do, and it got super violent. And soon, in August 18, Mao Zedong met with one of these Red Guards on the Tiananmen Square, and one of the girls' name is Bingbing, Song Bingbing, and Bingbing in China means mannerism and etiquette. And Mao Zedong asked him, does that mean manner? She said, yes, and he said, no, you have to be violent. So she changed her name to violence, and the whole thing got completely out of control. The disaster, the massacre that happened under Cultural Revolution is still a myth in today's history. Many Chinese courageous historians try to write about it. There are massacres of thousands that we don't hear about in the West. During that month alone, in August, in Beijing, 1966, the documented people beaten to death with 1,772 people. And there were numerous other people, their family members, that were forced to suicide. Some people got killed simply because they married a foreigner. Or some people got killed simply because they graduated from the previous Kuomintang military school. And all of this is a witch hunt. And eventually it developed to a movement that we call the five type of red people, which is the poor farmers, the laborers, the revolutionary military people. And then the black kind of five people is landlord, rich people, intellectuals, rightist. So the red one would persecute the black ones. And it got so severe that a lot of people died.
And what happened to the people who, I'm going to bring a tie into this, but I guess I think it's important to understand what happened to the people who led this charge for ideological purity. Did they triumph or did the movement turn on them? Can you ever be intellectually pure enough during this time?
You can't be intellectually pure enough. And also a lot of these children, they're children. They're like teenagers. There's one story where the son decided that the mother spoke a secret truth about how Mao was doing personal worship during the Cultural Revolution. And he decided that her mother was total demon, a product of the older society. He criticized his mother for about an hour, and then the next day he wrote a denouncing letter about his mother and sent it to the local communist office. And then the mother was taken away right away, and a few weeks later was killed. And he's been remorse about that for his entire life. One wants to believe that there is an ideological support for some of these actions, but sometimes there's not. It's pure violence. Ideological reasons are just the excuse. They might be used to justify it to the rest of Chinese populations.
So I bring this up and go into the history of the Cultural Revolution for two reasons. The first reason is I think it's key to understanding why China has had such a difficult time getting over communism, that you have not only a government, authoritarian from the top down, suppressing people, but you have neighbors self-policing. You've destroyed the fabric of civil society, you've made it impossible for a person to have the courage to speak out. But I also bring it up because one of the more interesting observations I've heard from you is that you're very concerned about what's happening in the United States right now and some of the parallels to the Cultural Revolution. So can you talk a little bit about that? What do you see as similar, and why is this so dangerous?
I became concerned when I actually believe that in Western society, you have the assumption of innocence before proven guilty. But right now, we're seeing mob culture jumping on people. It's very similar to what happened during the Cultural Revolution. The person that are being accused have no defense when the society turns on him and takes everything he has. What that does is that I see this in my father's generation. They become so afraid. They have no internal resource to resist that conformity. Eventually, they all become part of that wave that pushes for the next victim to be victimized. It's disillusioning, but also I still want to believe that our culture, human kindness, is stronger. And that's what I'm seeing in Chinese society, that even though the situation is so severe over there that a communist has all the power it has over the society, they have the social credit system, they monitor the phone, they monitor private messages between family members, but they are still courageous human rights lawyers that are fighting for other Chinese citizens' lives. And they have not given up. They're like thorns on Chinese communist thighs. There's also the Christians, the Falun Gong practitioners, who have been resisting decades of persecution, and they're still not giving up. And the reason why they're doing that is because they found the internal resource. I think maybe every generation needs to go through a process where we find our courage and integrity and define what we believe.
So the assumption, you know, 20 years ago was that China had economically liberalized and that political liberty was just around the corner. Now, the way that the Chinese government has set up its social contracts is that you don't derive legitimacy from the will of the governed. It's not democratic. It's from the promise that we'll provide you with economic stability, we'll make you prosperous, and in exchange for that, just be quiet about freedoms. So I guess what I'm asking is, why didn't political reforms accompany economic reforms? And what can we in the West do to encourage those political reforms and stand up for the human rights defenders?
Because economic prosperity was never the fatal enemy of totalitarianism and communism. And we see the example in China. Even though economic prosperity is in China, people did not find the courage to stand up for themselves. And the money that the West threw into China acted as this, it's almost like leverage for the Chinese Communist Party to keep Chinese people even more distracted on the money worshiping and on the material pursuit. And they have even less inside to wanting to stand up for themselves. What the way to really change is to let them find what their traditional culture, who they really are, and to defy communism. And I feel like the West in the past say that economic prosperity will bring political liberalization is more like a self-justifying rhetoric. Mm-hmm. To be able to do business with a regime that they know have killed millions of Chinese people. Otherwise, how will they justify their own action? You have a society that was based on rule of law.
So one of the things that I've noticed is that the Chinese government particularly cracks down on religious practitioners. You've got the Uyghur Muslims in Xinjiang province that are being put in concentration camps, that are being separated from their family members, forcible sterilizations, forcible abortions, atrocities that we can't imagine. You've got the Falun Gong practitioners, which you've spoken so powerfully about, organ harvesting, just things we can't imagine, cracking down on the Christian churches, demanding that they take down photos of Jesus, or pictures of Jesus, and replace them with pictures of Mao or with Xi. So what is it about religion in particular that is such a threat to the Chinese Communist Party?
Because it takes away their moral legitimacy and their legitimacy for rule and their moral authority. in every society, the traditional ones, and also in China, we had the ultimate moral authority as heaven. Even the kings and emperors were subject to the judgment of heaven. We didn't worship a specific god, but we had the nature of the universe as the guidance. We call it heaven, Lao Tian. So kings were called son of heaven. If the king did something wrong, according to Taoism and Buddhism, the nature works in accordance with what is going on in society. If there's natural disaster, huge things that are terrible happening in the society, the king needs to publish a huge self-reflection or self-criticism to all the citizens, and also to reduce his food consumption, to ask for advice from people, and to reduce his karma, to reduce his guilt, in order to appease the heaven. And in China, we worship history, like in the, how to say, the Confucian scholar took history and knowledge as a huge continuation of our civilization. Our historians were part of the authority in how to govern the government. The historians are usually the most knowledgeable, most wise, and have the best personal character. And it's very hard to get them to bend. So once the Communist Party took all of this away, there's still the traditional religion, the religion that still accepts a god. Once a person has that internal resource inside, they become very hard to subject under a totalitarian regime that is obviously doing the wrong thing. So that's why belief and acceptance of that there's something higher outside of all of us is the fatal thing that will destabilize communist rule.
Got it. So one of the really disturbing things I've seen happening in the West is Chinese propaganda beginning to infiltrate and have an effect not just on Chinese thinking, but on Western thinking. And one example of that is how quickly after coronavirus got out of China, they were able to deflect attention to say that if you criticize China, if you call it the Wuhan virus, that that's racist. But another example that you actually opened my eyes to is how they've been able to stigmatize Falun Gong. And so I was hoping maybe you could share what that actual religion teaches, a little bit about it, and what they've suffered under the Chinese government, because this is something that does not get enough attention in the West. Mm-hmm.
The Chinese propaganda here during the coronavirus, that is astonishing to how easily that Westerners can be manipulated by Chinese communist propaganda. Chinese Communist Party always say that they represent all Chinese people. Whenever someone criticizes the Chinese Communist Party, the communist official or their state media will say, oh, you have offended the entirety of Chinese people. You need to apologize. You have hurt our feelings. But that is just the rhetoric. They don't represent Chinese people. They have no legitimate claim over the feelings of Chinese people. And that's just the rhetoric to deflect any kind of criticism toward them. And when it comes to Falun Gong, it's a similar issue. That Falun Gong is this traditional Chinese Buddhist school, Tao school, Qigong practice. In China, in the ancient times, Chinese people do these yoga, Tai Chi practices to regulate their health. We believed, especially in Confucianism, we believed that in order to have righteous and complete character, you need to constantly stay in meditation, not constantly, you need to often stay in meditation to reflect yourself, to observe the universe, to be connected with the universe, have that inspiration coming into you. It's part of our culture. And during the Cultural Revolution, all of this was taken away. But then there is a cultural vacuum, spiritual vacuum. It's human nature to want something more spiritually. So Qigong practices, which are all these schools of yoga and Tai Chi came to Chinese society. And because they emphasize less on the spiritual terms of the Chinese traditional culture, they were trying to avoid persecution that way, but still get themselves spread. Now in the 1980s, it started to grow like really big. By 1990, there were a few very big Qigong schools in China, and Falun Gong was one of them. And then by mid-1990s, the Chinese government decided that this movement is actually not, it's bigger and it's getting out of our control, the whole Qigong movement. So they started to crack down on specific Qigong schools, a few of the biggest. So Falun Gong was not the first Qigong school to be persecuted. There was another one, but it soon disappeared. But Falun Gong practitioners, the only ones that publicly opposed the Chinese Communist Party's suppression, and they voiced different opinions, and they persisted in saying, we're not wrong in doing this. And that itself in Chinese society is unprecedented during the communist rule. I think it was Wall Street Journal, at that time it was Ian Johnson, he won a Pulitzer for this, talking about how Falun Gong brought an unprecedented challenge to the Communist Party's regime, solely because they're independent from the state.
So what have they done to Falun Gong practitioners? What evidence is there? You've spoken about organ harvesting, and that's something that we don't know a lot about in the West. The Chinese government's been good about covering it up. So what evidence is there, and on what scale is this happening?
Starting from 1999, because the Falun Gong movement, I wouldn't say it's movement, so many people started practice purely because they wanted to have better health. And a lot of elderlies joined. And so what they did is they tried to get these people to denounce their belief, to sign a piece of paper saying that I'll never practice Falun Gong again, this is a cult. But because once people found the truth, it's very hard to get them to give up. So they have to torture these people in order to get that piece of paper. And a lot of people refused to submit to this. So a lot of people were persecuted to death. And then in 2000, we found a huge trend of China's organ transplant hospital growing. According to Chinese traditional culture, we respect the integrity of the body. It's less likely, without a huge aggressive government promotion, that Chinese people will voluntarily give up their organs for organ transplant. So in China, in the past, the number of organ transplant surgery performed, it was just in the hundreds. It's not a lot at all. But then recently we found Chinese government, and this is starting from 2005, the Chinese hospitals aggressively promoting to Western tourists that they can find liver or heart, vital organs within 2 weeks, and they can schedule the surgery in the morning or in the afternoon. They can find your matching blood type. Anybody who's been waiting for an organ in the US would know that. That's like, unless you know when the donor is gonna die and the blood type, you can't schedule a surgery in advance. And in 2006, the average liver wait time in United States, I think it was 321 days, just under a year. So this is practically impossible if you were to do it in a free society. And so the researchers dug into the discrepancies between the surgeries performed and the claimed organ source, which at that time the Chinese Communist Party even did not admit that they use prisoners' organ. Then they say that they're using death row prisoners' organ. But death row prisoner, it's not a lot in China, and 50% of them are hepatitis, like it makes them ineligible to be an organ donor. So after years of research, all the circumstantial evidence collected, I think last year, in China Tribunal in United Kingdom, they have a group of legal researchers and medical examiners have found, concluded that this has been going on in China, the organ harvestings of prisoners of conscience on a large scale. And this deserves immediate attention.
So that's one human rights issue that I wish would get more attention. What are others?
I think when it comes to individual groups like Tibetans and Uyghurs and Christians, these ones is easier to define. You can say that is a persecution toward that race. But then the normal Chinese people, like human rights lawyers, journalists, people who have a little bit of courage to speak up for themselves, that type of persecution don't really get enough reporting.
So what are some of the names that our audience should know? Who are some of these people who are speaking out, who the West should be standing for, should be remembering their names, should be lobbying our Congress people to stand up for, but we just don't know about them?
One very prominent one, Gao Zhisheng, his wife and child is in America right now. He publicly spoke, he's a human rights lawyer, he publicly spoke against the persecution of Christians and Falun Gong practitioners and have been going through numerous kind of torture, persecution, setbacks, and disappeared for long periods of time. We need to pay more attention to these courageous Chinese people. What supported them to continue what they do is purely internal resource. There's nothing external that would help their decision making to fight a communist regime within the communist regime.
So when I'm looking at current situation in China, I see a government that's authoritarian in a way that it hasn't been since the Maoist days. Xi Jinping models himself in many ways on Mao. I see the government, you know, setting up social credits, limiting people's freedom of motion, using facial identification, using technology, collecting DNA, building a system that is basically totalitarianism 2.0. It's tech totalitarianism. So this would project a very strong and controlled government. At the same time in the last year, we've seen protests in Hong Kong that pose the biggest threat to the government since Tiananmen Square. You see a pandemic where average citizens have come out and lionized the doctor who was willing to speak out about this, criticized the government for suppressing him. So this almost seems contradictory to me, that on one hand you have a government that appears so strong, and on the other hand you see small pockets of dissent. Can you give me your analysis as to how strong or how weak relatively Xi Jinping is and what his vulnerabilities are?
Well, I guess I can say more about the government itself, because I feel like the central leader of the Communist Party carry the same characteristic of all level of Chinese Communist leaders. Mm-hmm. They care more about their rule, their legitimacy, their power than human life. And human life is an expense they're willing to give to continue their rule. So as long as they're in power, everything else doesn't really matter. We see that with the pandemic in Wuhan. At the beginning of when they first discovered the few cases in Wuhan, the first thing the local government did is to suppress the news. The courageous doctors who dare to tell other colleagues that this is going on, they had sent police to talk to them, and some were even like publicly denounced. And later on, the Wuhan government even hosted huge groups of Chinese New Year dinner, which helped the spread of the virus. They did not want to admit the spread of this pandemic until the first overseas case was discovered. It's like a Chernobyl. Unless someone holds them accountable for what they do, they can continue to lie. We see this powerful Frankenstein's monster projecting its power outside everywhere in One Belt, One Road projects, in buying off properties of critical infrastructures from the West. But internally, how much has left for real Chinese people to have a normal life?
So on one hand, you have this authoritarian government that's not only oppressing its own people, but teaching other countries how to follow the same model of corruption and oppression. Mm-hmm. On the other hand, you have the United States, you've got a West. Do you think that we are headed to a new Cold War type situation? You've got two competing, two competing superpowers. And if so, what are the advantages that the West has, and how can we help the people in China who actually want the things that we have in the West?
Well, I think it's really great that the West finally realized that, oh, maybe China's hostile. And there are more talks about it in the recent couple of years. Very happy to see that, because in our indoctrination since kindergarten, we've always been told that there's an anti-China black hand that's always at play, and their aim to subvert China, trying to sabotage China, destabilize Chinese society. Any kind of domestic problem was blamed onto the anti-China black hand. And nowadays, the Hong Kong movement, the Taiwan independence government, the Chinese government are claiming that the West is behind it. So Chinese Communist Party has always been hostile and has always taught its people to be hostile toward the West. And this Cold War for them has been going on for a very long time. You see their strategies and how it's buying off critical infrastructure, even infiltrating your culture, buying off Hollywood and entering joint ventures with big Hollywood studios, buying off AMC. So it basically gets to control what American culture, American audiences get to see or not get to see.
I don't think Americans realize how much influence the Chinese government has over Hollywood. You're an actress. in addition to being a human rights activist, can you talk from personal experience about how your activism has limited your opportunities and some of the more egregious concessions Hollywood has made to the Chinese government?
Right, so I think everybody here probably has heard how Hollywood changes its script to kowtow to Beijing, trading artistic integrity for market access. And a Chinese government also obsessively going online and try to chase what individual celebrities have said, what they published on social media. I remember one model got banned because she held a Buddha face cookie beside her face and then made a small Asian eye, and the Chinese government took offense of that. And things like that, just very random. And what they want is that, not that they really get offended by these actions, like Dolce & Gabbana put chopstick in their fashion show. They don't care. Like, they're stronger than that. But what they want is absolute conformity. They keep getting offended by different things that you do. And then you finally go like, okay, I'm sorry, but what do you want? You tell me what to do. That's what the Chinese government want.
Mm-hmm. So they're testing their power out on some of these culture war things. And the expectation is if Hollywood will give on the small issues, if our fashion designers, if our artists will concede on small, trivial cultural issues, when we come at them with something really important, they will submit to.
They are testing the water. They are seeing if you want to compromise or not. If you're willing to compromise, you have to push it all the way to the wall. Mm-hmm. But speaking on the Hong Kong issue, you have written a lot about Hong Kong. And I've always wondered what draw you into this movement and your dedication to this whole movement.
So my first job out of college was in Hong Kong. I got to go for the Wall Street Journal for 4 months and live there and report on the elections in Macau and try to figure out how the Chinese Communist Party was rigging the elections and rigging the outcome. Now, when I went to Hong Kong 10 years ago, it was more economically free than the United States. The Chinese Communist Party had rigged legislative council, but you had freedom of the press. You had freedom of speech, you had freedom of religion. Christians from mainland China will come to Hong Kong to practice. And you had economic freedom in a way that even in the West, you couldn't imagine. You could start a business, you could do all these entrepreneurial things. And it was just a beautiful place. And so when they last year decided to introduce an extradition bill that would effectively destroy one country, two systems, allow the Chinese government to put out a warrant for anyone in Hong Kong, journalists, human rights activists, business people that they wanted to coerce, they could haul them off to mainland China and do whatever they wanted under the system of justice. This was a total farce, and it threatened a city that I really love. And so I've been there several times in the last year reporting on this, and I think it's honestly the heroism of people like you who are willing to sacrifice so much to stand up for the values and ideals that I hold dear. It's changed the way that I look at freedom in the West, but then it's also been really sad. I mean, we were talking about names that you should remember. One of them is Jimmy Lai. He's the Rupert Murdoch of Asia, publisher of Apple Daily. It's called Apple Daily because he's a devout Christian and has said that if Eve hadn't eaten the apple, we wouldn't have news. But she did, so we have Apple Daily. But he has homes in Paris. He has homes in all over the world. He's got a British passport. He's somebody that has the money and the influence to get out and keep himself and his family safe. But instead, he's chosen to stay in Hong Kong to speak out about what the Communist Party really is, the ugly nature of this regime, and they've gone after him. They've just arrested him under the new national security legislation, which is the death knell of China. I don't know what this law is doing. Is basically criminalizing every form of dissent. And instead of, like the extradition bill would have, taken Hong Kongers to the mainland, that was defeated. So what the Chinese government now is doing is bringing the mainland system of justice to Hong Kong. And so Jimmy is one of these people who is laying down his life for the Hong Kong people. He's somebody who could get out, but is choosing to stay. And so when they persecute someone like that, it's sending the message to the millions of protesters I saw on the streets that I've interviewed, some of them, that if this billionaire can't escape the Chinese government, you can't either. It's intended to terrify the people. And it's not just Jimmy who's standing up against this. It is people who saw what happened in Tiananmen, but it's also high school students who are sitting there, skipping their soccer practice, sipping a Frappuccino, telling me about how they're willing to sacrifice their life for freedom. And I think when you hear that, you love a city even more.
That one of the most interesting thing I find about this Hong Kong movement is that Hong Kong people reacted so differently, the young people. They are reacted so differently from the Chinese mainlander. And also, when the Chinese students went very aggressive in criticizing Hong Kong students, we see that in communities outside, universities, when a wall has been taken down and Hong Kong students have been shouted at. What do you think about that?
So I think the Chinese government is terrified that its people will understand what's happening in Hong Kong. Mm-hmm. And one of the more remarkable things has been watching them try to, I guess, use mainland propaganda to hide the truth of it. So last year when there were protests, some of them, the majority of them, millions in the street, were peaceful. Some protesters also felt that it was their Boston Tea Party moment, that they needed to target the symbols of power because this was an oppressive government, it was an illegitimate government, and it was going after their life. So you did see destruction of property. You did see starting of fires. And I think that while I understand the logic behind it, it was a tactical error. The Chinese government used that to say, we've got the history of the Cultural Revolution, look at this. If you want freedom, you're endorsing anarchy. And so they branded the entire movement as disruptive, as something that was going to cause violence, when actually they were saying, no, you Chinese Communist Party have brutalized your own people for decades, and we're standing up to it, we're drawing a red line, we'll put our bodies on the line to fight this. And it, you know, talking to people who follow this really closely, the mainland coverage, I think that they were afraid. I think that they were afraid that if they heard Hong Kongers saying what they told me, which is, look, we're on the front line of this. Chinese culture is compatible with democracy. Chinese culture is compatible with freedom and liberty. If revolutions start that way, revolutions start when enough people understand that they're dissatisfied with the system, that they can have something better, and that they won't be sticking their head out alone. So I think Hong Kongers, to their credit by the millions, were trying to send the message to mainlanders that what the Chinese government stands for isn't okay. The Chinese government was very effective in suppressing that message, but I think it gets at one of the key vulnerabilities, which is that this government doesn't exist for its people, it exists to exploit its people.
Can you talk to us about the national security law? Because I've talked to some Western journalists, they're asking me to explain to them what this law is about. But I think what Westerners, a lot of them don't understand is that it's not a law, it's a tool. Mm-hmm. It's phrased vaguely, intentionally, so that the power of interpretation is completely upon the Beijing government.
Yeah, this law is terrifying in its scope. Mm-hmm. So what the government is saying is, on the surface, they say this is only going to affect a very small minority of people. But what it actually does is say that anyone who threatens national security, who tries to subvert the government, who cultivates a sense of hatred or dislike of the government, is guilty. And that Hong Kong has been known for rule of law. Its judiciary has been independent. You've got a chief executive who's effectively appointed by Beijing. You've got a legislature that is rigged, but the judiciary has stood independent, and that's the legacy of the British system. What this does is it sidelines the judiciary, says that only judges appointed and approved by Beijing can decide national security cases. So they are effectively judge, jury, prosecutor, and executioner in these cases. And by the way, I think this is the thing that nobody's really caught on to that's incredibly important. It's not claiming that its jurisdiction is just over Hong Kong. And it's not claiming its jurisdiction is just over Hong Kong people or Chinese people. This law, it claims, applies to anyone in the world. You could post in favor of Hong Kong. And in theory, under this law, in absentia, they could try you and convict you as a subverter of state security. Now, the other really, I think, nefarious thing that this does is it claims that anyone doing business in Hong Kong or the mainland must not abate those undermining national security. And so it's basically claiming the right to go to Google and say, if Anastasia Lin has spoken out against Hong Kong, or has spoken out against the Chinese government's crackdown in Hong Kong, and she's in the United States, we're going to go to our local Google and say, you have to hand over all of her emails. And if you don't do it, we're coming after you. If she posts something on Facebook, they'll go to the local Facebook officials. This is what this law is claiming, saying I'll take it down. And it's not just her, it's if I do it, it's if you do it. So the scope of this law is truly terrifying, and I think it tells us a lot about China's ambitions, not just for controlling its own population, but for effectively controlling culture and controlling political speech around the world.
Mm-hmm. So where do you think the future of Hong Kong lies?
I think it's going to be a tragedy. I hope I'm wrong. I think what the Chinese government is so afraid of is that this is how revolutions start. You have people that say enough and are willing to have the courage to stand up to those convictions. Hong Kongers have had it in the millions. What I'm afraid of is that you already see them cracking down on Hong Kong and coming at them as hard as they can. And I am terrified of what's going to happen to those people. I think that the West needs to stand up for them and realize that this is a defining moment for freedom in the world.
Do you think the West has leverage to help Hong Kong?
It's really difficult. We passed Hong Kong Human Rights and Security Act, or Democracy Act. We're beginning to start imposing sanctions on those violating the rights of Hong Kongers, also those Chinese officials going after the Uyghurs. I think we need to do a lot more of it, but I think we also need to look at this not just as a political equation, but as an economic equation, as a cultural equation. Because this isn't just about what's happened in Hong Kong, it's not even just about what's happened in mainland China. It's about an authoritarian or totalitarian government's ability to control political speech around the world. So with that, I'm going to open it up to your questions. We don't have a ton of time. I hear there's a tablet somewhere that you can submit them.
We've got it, and I'm going to consolidate a lot of these. You guys have answered a lot of these over the course of this conversation, so thank you for that. A lot of questions about Taiwan. How does Taiwan come into play? What is the long game? Should we be worried about a full takeover of Taiwan by China?
Yes, we should. They've never been willing to recognize Taiwan as an independent country. They still claim jurisdiction. They've worked very hard to isolate Taiwan from the international community, everything from excluding it from the UN to when Taiwanese health experts understood early on the scope of this pandemic, blocking them out of World Health Organization meetings, even if it endangered global public health. And so I think they're moving on Hong Kong today. I think it's a legitimate concern that if they get away with this, they'll move on Taiwan. And it also sets an example that democracy is not incompatible with Chinese values, and that's really dangerous to the Communist Party.
Yeah. Well, Hong Kong people, for me, it represents the Chinese people without being tainted by communism. But what's happening internally in Taiwan is that Chinese Communist Party also is infiltrating Taiwan society through politicians, through the media, and also through business people. And I was quite worried before the last Taiwan election, because a lot of medias were speaking on behalf of the I would say much more pro-Beijing than they should. But Taiwan people still made a decision. I think Hong Kong was a very good wake-up call what's happening in Hong Kong. So good luck to those people.
Within China, do the Chinese people know about the situation with the Chinese Uyghurs? And if they do, in what context?
Inside China, before I came out, I didn't know. There's a lot of Chinese people who don't know, but there's also a lot that are trying to climb over the Great Firewall to see the situation outside. They have the software that breaks the internet blockage. So those people are a little more clear. But majority of the Chinese people, throughout Chinese Communist movement, they pick a small group of people to be the public enemy and persecute those people. Everybody else learned that if they just keep themselves safe and keep their distance, draw their clear line, they can stay safe. But they create the fear that no one is willing to speak up for other people. And eventually, the disvalue of life, they don't value individual life as the way that we understand fundamentally in the West. So to sacrifice a small group of people to earn the greater good for the bigger group of people is what Communist Party has always justified its violence.
How is the internet different there than it does here? You know, we can access things we probably don't need to access here on our internet. How locked down is the internet in China?
You have sensitive words that if you type in, let's say, Christianity, Falun Gong, Tiananmen massacre, all those words is completely blocked. And also, recently, Chinese government has been tightening the control on people who are trying to climb over the firewall. People are much more smarter now. If the communists come up with a way, they find other ways to go around it. But still, a majority of the people, if they listen to Chinese media only, they wouldn't know anything else that's going on. And worse still, they will listen to the Chinese hatred propaganda about America, about the trade war, about different groups of that are even actually trying to stand up for the Chinese people's rights.
And I would also add to that, well, first of all, it's a testament to the ingenuity of the Chinese people that they're able to get around it. My favorite example is, you know, June 4th was the Tiananmen Square massacre for a while. What was it, May 5th that was trending, or May 3rd?
May
4th. Or May 35th, right?
Oh!
Yeah. But there's all this wordplay around it. But I would say that I think this is one area where there's real opportunity for the United States. To just in the same way with the Soviet Union, we had Radio Free America, you know, broadcasting there, saying there's an alternative. I would like to see the United States dedicate much more resources to allowing Chinese people to read the truth about their government, whether it's the fundamental corruption that robs people of opportunities or the horrific killings.
What should the U.S. policy be towards China? We've seen President Trump get tough on trade, but not so much on human rights. So what needs to be the stance here?
Be much more vocal and principled, as you always should have been. We have tried the appeasement policy with China, the whole Western world, for the last 30 years, and it didn't work. We have to admit that it did not work. We thought that we're going to change their value by bringing them economic prosperity. But it's the other way around. They have changed our value. They have corrupted our institution. Now, by being more vocal, that is the first stance, because Chinese Communist Party acts like a high school bully. You draw the line, then they recognize that they will respect that. They might not immediately respect that, but they know that they can't bully you anymore.
Yeah, in the short term, I think encouraging internet access in China is really important. I also think standing up for Taiwan, I'd like to see a trade relationship deepen with them. I'd like to see us being a reliable ally, because I think countries like Japan, like Korea, you know, some of the countries, Philippines, dealing with their increasing aggression and the shenanigans that they pull in the South China Sea, I think the United States saying we stand for rule of law, we're not going to put up with this, would help form a balance of power against the Chinese government.
May I just piggyback on that? Mm-hmm. Also, we should join force with the other allies, because Canada, Australia, they're all facing intimidation from China. Two Canadian citizens were arrested because of the Meng Wanzhou arrest in Vancouver. And Australia has been intimidated, its citizens arrested, trade been economic coercion. The tactic Chinese Communist Party used for every country is the same. It's time for us to unite, to go against that.
What do normal, average Chinese people think of the United States?
Depends on what they have access to. It can be drastically different.
Yeah, I'd agree with that. I will never forget in Beijing having a cab driver who I got in and I said I was American, and he looked at me a little slyly and started humming God Bless America.
Oh, wow.
One last question. Should the United States intervene directly in the new Hong Kong security law? So far we've talked about it, the government has made us aware of it, but nothing, no real action has taken place there. What should the United States' role be, if any, in what's happening in Hong Kong?
I actually want you to answer this because you have a fantastic answer. You and David Rivkin wrote a piece about specifically when the Chinese government goes after Facebook, goes after Google, goes after American companies and tries to suppress political speech and bully them, what the West should do. It's an answer I haven't heard anywhere else. So.
Oh, sure. She's talking about a piece of op-ed I wrote for the Wall Street Journal, and actually my angle came from a much more personal angle. Because of my human rights work, the Chinese government has constantly trying to not just intimidate my family in China and also monitoring my my actions in the West. Anybody who, my sponsors in the past have been directly harassed by the Chinese Communist Party and withdraw their sponsorship. And because of that, I felt really vulnerable, because I can't ask a business whose priority is to make money, to sacrifice that to stand up with me. So, and American businesses are facing exactly the same situation. So David Rifkin and I wrote this piece to talk about how we can maybe help the American corporations get a little more spine. Back in the, basically this is about when the Arabics are boycotting Israel, they had this law in US that if you're helping or in some way to inform the Arabic government about your dealing with Israeli companies or helping in the persecution, like the boycott of the Israeli companies, you basically violate US law. So now can we make it that if US companies are helping Chinese government with their rhetoric, for example, labeling Taipei as China Taipei, or suppressing their support for Dalai Lama, then we can make them, hold them accountable for their actions. And this is not to punish the US corporation. It's actually to help them to tell the Chinese government, we have this law back home, we can't do what you tell us to do. It's a strong protection for them.
Anastasia Lin, Jillian K. Melchior, this was fantastic. Thank you so much for your time.